Good evening.
Good evening.
Good to be here again. It's been probably, 2 months since I've been here. And in 2 months, the situation got so much worse. Who would believe that in 2 months, half of this country will be bankrupt after hundreds of years of success? To build a building takes years. To lose it can be a second. If you remember, maybe about a year, even before that, a year ago, when I spoke here and in different places, I already started to tell people that we are in front of a financial tsunami, that everything is going to go down and collapse. It's all recorded. It started at the end of 2006 already, when business was booming. Like they say, everything you touch becomes gold. People buy, sell, flip real estate. Everyone is in the stock market. Everyone is in a good mood. Not everyone, but most of the people were doing supposedly well. I started to realize that it's a balloon, that you blow the balloon, it gets better by the minute. But there's a limit. Once the balloon explodes, all the air comes out in moments, seconds. To blow the balloon takes longer. To lose the air, 1, 2, 3 seconds, and it flies and crashes everywhere. Lose balance. I want to tell you a statement now. Yeah, maybe you think I exaggerate, maybe you already realize it yourself. It's the pen. Everyone has a different opinion. But in my opinion, that's before I'm getting the Torah's opinion involved here. In my personal opinion, this is the worst financial crisis in the history of this world since the 7 years of starvation that was in the world in the time of Pharaoh, 3,400 years ago. The 7 bad years in the world that everybody lost everything they had, and there was only one country that they were depend on to give them food, which was Egypt. Everybody is familiar with the story in the Torah, right? The Jew, Yosef, became the treasury of Egypt. He predicted what's going to happen based on a dream. There's only one different part to the story. That then there was one empire, Egypt, it was like the United States today, that was doing very well. Because they were preparing for the 7 bad years. So they had 7 years to gather, accumulate as much as they could. Here, today in the world, there's not even one country that is not in a jeopardy of going bankrupt. 2 days ago, they have the committee, the G18, not 7, G18, 18 countries gathered in Brazil. They had a meeting. So the president of that committee, this is his words. And you know, usually they hide a lot more than what they know. They don't want to create panics. So if the situation is 90% bad, they say 60, 50. You know, they don't like to say the real truth. Later you find out the real truth. Companies never tell you the truth. So he said like this, this is his words. There is not even one country in the world that is not suffering and that the future of this country is in a big danger. That's his words. You may think, okay, maybe it's Europe, America, Israel, countries like this, you know. What about Kuwait, Saudi Arabia? They sold so much, they made so much money on the oil. They basically, one of the major reasons why the world is in the situation that it is right now. Because besides the mortgages, what happened in the world for the last 2 years, everything that used to cost $5 to make became $30, $20. Why? Because oil went up. Oil goes up. Everything in the world goes up. There's not one thing in the world that does not connect directly to the price of the gas, of the oil. Why? Gas, trucks, shipping, UPS, FedEx, boats, everything goes based on oil, right? You want to ship from Israel to here. Oil is 10 times more now. From 30 went to 150, 5 times more. It's another $20 for each piece to ship it because it's expensive. So the prices goes up. The Arabs took all the money from all over the world and they have plenty of money. And it was all a conspiracy. They planted it that way. The Iran, the Arabs, Venezuela with them. That's how they're going to knock down United States and Europe. The only problem is one thing they didn't take to their consideration. that when you become the rich guy in a neighborhood and all your neighbors become very poor, you don't have customers anymore. You don't have who to sell. Now, it's going to take a few more months to reflect on them. Still doing okay. They don't feel it yet. But countries like them, or even China, they depend on the United States. And when people in the United States don't have money for bread and cheese, they're not going to buy made in China all kinds of toys and food and carpets and furniture. People will stay with their furniture now for who knows how many years. No renovation, no renovation, China lose. No leather couches, China lose. People don't buy cars, there's less cars on the road. All the Arab countries are losing. Iran, they support all the terrorism from the oil they sold. The oil prices will go down back to 30, as it was. You have to understand, oil prices, people don't really calculate it right. I'll give you an example of what I mean. Let's say they used to sell 2 or 3 years ago a barrel of oil for $30, and then people used to complain that it's too expensive. After all the expenses of people, employees, all the machines they have, insurance, you know, it's a lot of expenses involved, shipping, whatever. Let's say they used to make $2 or $3 net on every barrel, right? I'm just assuming. $2, $3, 10% net profit, let's say, on every barrel. After all the expenses, taxes, whatever. So now, if on $30 they used to make, let's say, $3 profit. If the $30 went up to $150, and it was there for a while, $140, $150, how much they make on each barrel? Instead of $2, $3, how much they make? $120! Not 2, 3, 60 times, 70 times more. It's not just a little increase, because their expenses stay the same. The people in Saudi Arabia and Iran still make the same amount of money for an hour, or maybe less. Nothing went up for them. It was net profit. For 2, 3 years, they gathered all the money. Guess what happened right now in the United States? All the buildings go bankrupt. People cannot afford. People don't pay rents. People don't pay mortgages. Banks losing buildings. Banks, the owners don't pay the mortgage. They can't. So the banks takes the building. Who are they going to sell it to? There's no buyers. So they sell it to Arabs. Every second, Arabs buying buildings in Manhattan, everywhere. Chicago, here, there. They're buying this country. Before the crisis started, I once saw an email. 7% of United States owned by one Arab, one Saudi, Sheikh Bandar, before the problems. They have so much money, they don't know what to do with that. They have trillions of dollars. So what is a building that used to be 100 million went down to 20, 30 now. The bank is begging. Comes, he buy it, cash, doesn't need mortgage. He writes a check, he buy it. Tomorrow, another building. Everything here owns by them. That's what's happening right now. This is a serious situation right now, because every moment you turn the news on, you go into the news, you find out that another major company went bankrupt. Yesterday one, today one, tomorrow a bank. Now Ford and GM is also bankrupt. They're bankrupt officially now. The government has to give them $50 billion. $50 billion. That's besides the $700 billion to save the banks. They have to give them $50 billion. They're asking. They never tell you the real situation. They first start with 50. After they're going to get the 50 from the government, 2 months later they say it's not enough, we need another 100. So they need a lot of money. Who's going to pay for this money? We have to pay for it. Ford were making money on us all these years, GM, all these companies. They never gave us from their premium or for the money they were making. They're keeping it for themselves. Now the people of this country have to pay for them not to go back, not to go down. Now why the government must give them the money? It's not even a question. Why? Because if the government don't give them the money, there will be another 2 million American unemployed. They don't have 2 million employees, those two companies. But there are 2 million Americans that have food on their plate thanks to these two companies. Why? There are hundreds of companies that relates to them. Tire company, plastic companies, leather seat, light bulbs. You know how many companies are connected to GM and Ford? If they go down, all these companies go down. And companies in Europe go down. And companies in China go down. It's thousands of companies go down. That means millions of people don't have what to eat. When the people don't have what to eat, what do? They used to live here in fancy areas. Now they cannot pay. They used to make a lot of money. Now everything went down to zero. They owe a lot of money. It was all an illusion. He thought, I'm a rich guy. Look what a company I have. One day he woke up. No more GM. There's no customers. Where is he going to sell? He's stuck with millions of dollars in his storages. Who knows? Maybe tens of millions. He owes the bank. In 1 second, he goes bankrupt. But he still lives in a fancy house. He has a lot of expenses. Now, he begins to look around. He sees Jews around him driving nice cars. Drives him crazy. Anyone, not only Jews, especially the Jews. People, the crime in this country will go thousands of percent higher every month now. Already there's robberies everywhere you go. Why? When people don't have money and have hungry children at home, they have nothing to lose anymore. What do I have to lose? Worst comes to worst, they catch me, rob a bank. I'll sit in prison, they'll give me food. Anyway, I don't have what to eat. Can't pay my bills, they're going to take away anyway my house. I have nothing to lose. People will get people out of their cars in the middle of highways with guns. You don't understand, because this is not just another crisis, bad economy, rabbi, depression. There are already, by the minute, thousands of people every day extra become poor, every day. And these people, they need money. They got to get it somewhere. Even casinos, where in the history of this country casinos were going bankrupt? The rich, casino was the safest business, the safest investment. It's like, comes before food. People go to gamble before they go to eat. All these addicted people, they don't have money to gamble. The biggest guy in a casino is a Jew, you know, Adelson. He lost in 1 month $40 billion. Las Vegas cent went from $150 to $5. And this is, he has a lot of other buildings, real estate. He's bankrupt. He's lucky, he's about 8 years old. So his life is anyway, he's about to be, who knows. So finally, you know, his company went down to almost zero. He's not the only one. I know, just from what I heard, about many Jewish billionaires, some I know personally, and some I know from other people. Not one of them did not lose money. Some lost hundreds of millions, some lost billions. One guy stopped giving charity completely to all the organization. Now, this is a chain reaction. Why? Because if you remember in previous lectures, we spoke that the energy of the Jewish nation, the success, the existence of the Jewish nation depends on Torah. The non-religious Jews, they don't realize it. They don't know that the oxygen they breathe and the food that they eat comes from the power of the Torah, because this is the heart of the world, the Torah. The world was created based on the Torah. God made the world. Torah means instruction, Hora'ah, as instructions to the people. Everything goes around the Torah. So now let's assume there's 100,000 scholars learning in all the yeshivot in the world, in Israel, in America, in Europe, everywhere. Let's say 100,000, maybe I exaggerate, maybe it's not even 30. But let's just give a number. Who was sponsoring this yeshivot until now? Some of the money used to come for ordinary people, send monthly checks, 100, 500, 1,000, 2,000, small amounts. The major tycoons, billionaires, they used to sponsor most of their money for this yeshivot. A yeshiva like in Lakewood, they have 3,000 people. They need more than $1 million easy a month just to pay the bills. Cleaning, the electric, the mortgages, the teachers, the married people to give them salaries. Now, if a guy used to give them every month $5 or $10 million donation, and he stopped, what's going to happen? The Rosh Yeshiva used to get every month, I'm just picking up numbers, don't hold me by the numbers, I'm just giving it as an example. Let's see if he had every month $1 million donation. Now, from $1 million, in 1 month, he went down to 100,000. For years, he was getting approximately, more or less, around $1 million. He went down to 100,000. So now, he doesn't have where to pay. It's a big operation. So he cannot now start walking on doors and knock, hey, give me, they give him $200, $500. In 1 second, he's going to have to send from 3,000 people, 2,000 home right away. What's these people going to do? Most of them don't even know what job. I mean, they're learning Torah all their life, since they're kids. So not only they're not going to be able to find a job, they're not going to have food. And the worst problem is what? What's the worst problem? That there's less Torah now. If something was keeping us alive, after all these empires were trying to destroy us in history, the Torah say, what's our energy, what's our savior, the Torah. Now we're going to have less Torah and less Torah, chas v'shalom, God forbid. That makes the situation a lot worse. It's all chain reaction. From now on, it's time to tie the belt. You know, people have to think before they buy a gum in a supermarket. Now you may think, you say to me, okay, listen, you're exaggerating. Fine, the situation is very bad, but you don't really know me. I already had 10 very good deals. I put $5 million aside. Safe money, it's in saving accounts. No risky investment. Here, I show you my Citibank statement, $1 million. Chase, $2 million. Dear, $1 million. All together, I have enough money in a worse scenario to live with my kids and everything for the next 30, 40 years. I'm not worried. Illusions, baloney. Why? If you remember a month ago, you woke up in the morning and Washington Mutual, one of the largest 10 banks in America, went bankrupt. The government forced other banks to take them over. You see, the government has power. Buy them. If not, we'll finish you. The government forced other banks to take them over. Then Wachovia, the fourth largest bank in America and one of the largest in the world, also went bankrupt. The government forced another bank to take them over. How many banks there are in this country? Soon you're going to have another 100 banks going bankrupt. Who's going to take them over? So now you're thinking, my money is in the bank, is safe. You have no idea, you're dreaming. Because when other banks go bankrupt, and when all the companies go bankrupt, the banks are in a big risk. One day you come to your bank, you want to get cash out, that's it, no more cash. It can come either because the bank went down and there's nobody to buy them anymore, and you are FDIC insured to, I don't know, 200,000 and all the millions are gone. Or the government will make a rule. Two possibilities. One possibility, like in Argentina, the government one day announced no one is allowed to take more than X amount of money from the ATM per week, which was a ridiculous amount. If you live in a fancy house, it wouldn't be enough to pay the electric bill, what you took. Forget about food and everything else that you need. You cannot touch the money. That's what saved Argentina from losing the country. In Iceland, they went bankrupt. That's it. Everybody lost all their money. All the people of Iceland lost all their money. A week ago, they announced on the news. The government, the people, the banks, the companies, it's all bank. A year ago, they were speaking on the news. A year ago, we didn't have enough to produce all the orders. I was directing customers to other factories. I didn't have enough employees to cover all their orders. And in 1 year, everything went to zero there. In Uzbekistan, also, those small countries are the first one to die. Then it goes to the larger, and it's like a complete mess in the whole world. So the government can announce, we don't have any more where to bring hundreds of billions. We're printing dollars like crazy. The value of the dollar will go to nothing. You cannot buy anything with that anywhere you go. The value of the dollar anyway is going down. So the government will make a rule. No one can take money until this country gets saved. What's better? You want the country to go down and you have money? They don't care. They're going to change the rule here. It has nothing to do. There's another possibility that they're going to change the coin. They will tell you the dollar is no more dollar. They're going to call it some kind of name. And in 1 second, the value of it will go from $1 to really 5 pennies. That's what they're going to do. They did it in Israel, if you remember. They changed the lira to a shekel. That's it. What do you do? You have a lot of money. You have $10 million. In 1 second, it became $200,000. Whatever you have, your house was $10 million. Now it's really worth $200,000, $300,000. Everything in America went down. But the change will save the country, but make you 30 years of saving goes to the garbage. I don't want to scare you, but somebody already told me that they already have this money ready. They started to already prepare it. I don't know if it's reliable or not. I hope not, because if yes, what's going to happen here in the next few months? But that's what he says. And I don't know where he got that news. And usually this guy is very reliable. He's in the business world. He's always connected. And he told me that's the plan. People in the Jewish world became very nervous when Obama became the president. I don't understand, because in one way they say that 77% of the Jews vote for him. On the other hand, every Jew you speak to is very nervous. So I don't really know how it matches. But let's talk about these few minutes. First of all, the problem that Jews have, if they think that it comes from one king or one president, that's really the wrong way to look at things. The decision that God is taking on Rosh Hashanah is one decision. If he wants us to have a good year, then he moves everyone around according to his plan. If the decree was that everyone would lose everything they have and people will start wake up to make repentance before Mashiach will come, then he's going to put a very bad king with very bad decrees. Or, God forbid, it will be another wave of pogroms and everything like in the history. And the Jews will start to scream, God save me. What do you think? Who are they going to scream to? To the police? Remember what happened in Crown Heights? When was that? 15 years ago? For 2-3 days, the blacks in Crown Heights used to throw rocks at the Chabadnikim, the Chabad, and burn their cars, break the glasses, and police were standing in the time of Mayor Dinkins, doing nothing for like this. They stand for 2-3 days. They don't do anything. Police standing around. Police. The policeman thinking, why should I run, protect them? If it was up to me, I would shoot them. I'm going to go and risk my life, get a stone in my head. That's the way the policeman is thinking. What do you think? The policeman is a different Gentile? He was coming from a different planet? Just because he got a badge and he makes $30,000, $40,000 a year, he's going to be a Jew lover to risk his life for it? So what's going to happen? When they're going to start starving all the employees, they're going to come to the boss and knock on his door at home. Give us food. We're dying. My children are hungry. Give me a loan, $10,000. He's going to have to give it to them. Because if he's going to tell them, I cannot give you, what do you think is going to happen? They're going to start taking things out of the house. They did it in Germany. They walk in and they took away your house. In the beginning, of course, the police are going to get involved and they're going to bring protection. But once they're going to see it's an epidemic, the police will say, there's nothing we can do. Protect yourself. Shotguns. Shotguns. In New York, it's legal shotguns, but it has to be long, one lawyer told me. You cannot have a gun. It has to be a long one that you cannot hide. That's the idea behind it. Why it has to be a long one? Because you cannot hide it and go and rob a bank or a policeman. If you have a big rifle, then you're allowed to self-defense. In Texas, if you knock on someone's door, let's say 11 o'clock at night, you're a mover, you came with a truck, you knock on the other house by mistake. He doesn't even have to talk to you. He opens the door and shoots you, and he's 100% safe. He doesn't even get arrested. Why? You own his property. Really, technically, in Texas, if a guy hates his mailman, if he comes to put the mail in a box and he shoots him, he's also safe. Why? He killed him on his own property. Let's assume he didn't see his uniform, night, whatever. That's what happened. In Israel, they also made that law now. In Israel, if somebody goes into your territory and you shoot him, it just happened a week ago, for the first time. The guy didn't get arrested, and it was Arabs. They break into the house and steal. They go to the farmers, they steal sheep. So this is the situation. It doesn't matter if the president is pro-Israel, not Israel, he loves Jews, he doesn't love Jews, so supposedly he got some of his helpers to be Jewish. It doesn't really matter. Really, the people focus on the wrong idea. The president is a puppet. The Torah says that once you get elected to be a king, a president, you don't have a free choice like before. That's the only people in the world that God interferes with their free choice. I just read last week, if you remember King Hussein of Jordan, the father of this king now, he died from cancer. You know, you heard about Rabbi Kaduri in Israel? There was a big Kabbalist, Rabbi Kaduri. He lived, they said, to 111 years old, something like that. He just died about a year or two ago, something like that. So King Hussein knew about him. That is one of the important rabbis in Israel. He's a Mekubal, Kabbalist. He sent him, he called him on the phone, and he spoke to him in Arabic, because Rabbi Kaduri was born in Iraq, speak Arabic. So he spoke to him, he told him, give me a blessing that I should be healthy. So he told him, if you come to me, this is what Rabbi Kaduri told him, If you come to me, I'm going to write you a special kamea, special thing according to the Kabbalah, on a special card like a mezuzah. You put it on your body, for sure your life will get saved. And they hang up the phone. He told his students he won't come. They told him why. Already he knew that his sentence is to die. So he told them his Ara pride will not let him come all the way from Jordan to my little apartment here in Jerusalem. And right after a month he died. That's what happened. They wrote it in a book. One of his students wrote stories from his life. They put that, one day they sat and learned Torah, and they got a phone call from King Hussein and was speaking to him, and that's what happened. What do you think? What made him not come? God wanted to get rid of him for whatever reason. His time came, that's it. Already interfere with his free choice as a king. Why? Because kings, if they're going to go by their own opinion, it's going to change the plan of the creation. God wants this country to be in a war, but the king doesn't want a war. But the plan is that they need to go into war. Now they're going to ruin the plan. You understand? So God has to interfere with the choice of the kings. But not with their own personal choices. If to put tefillin or not, there's no interference if Olmert will put tefillin or not. Or the other one, Livni. She put tefillin or not. There's no... I guess you don't even know who she is. Very good. Anyway... There's no interference with what they do. But what that comes for the Israel, like with Sharon, to send to give back Gaza to the Palestinians, it was unfortunately a decree from Shammai that we have to lose all these beautiful places and houses and give it to them. And they went and took it over and we got nothing in return. We lose parts of Israel, as the Torah says, "Ve'ne'saftem el arechem." You're going to shrink and the enemies among you will go higher and higher and you go lower and lower, the Torah says. Why? Because you don't listen to me. Everything that happens now in the world, there's only one reason for it. God is sick and tired from the behaving of the people in the world. Sex, crimes, every second, everywhere in the world. Idols, worshipping idols. Half of the world worshipping idols. Everywhere you go, in India, China, all this Thailand, places like this, bowing down to idols. They just had a tsunami, 200,000-300,000 people died to wake them up, to stop with their prostitution and what happened over there. Nobody gets the message. Iran, 70,000 people died in an earthquake. A normal country would think, why God did it to us? He's not satisfied with us. They went back. Terrorism, problems, everything goes back. Palestinians, they kill one another now. They don't wake up. But we're the one who should spread the light to the world. We are the worst. Because we have intelligence, Torah. They also have intelligence, but they don't have Torah. We got the book of God. God told us what to do, what not to do. And he also told us what's going to happen to us if we're not going to follow it. As individuals, as also as a nation. But what we think, it doesn't happen overnight. There is a period of time that the sins all over the world are accumulated. It keeps going higher and higher and higher until it gets to a point that God is stepping in and beginning to make revolutions. Tsunamis, earthquakes, hurricanes, an atomic war in Japan. Things in the world to wake up the people. Nobody is waking up. The Gemara said that everything happens to the world always connect to Israel, to the Jews, even when there's no state of Israel. Everything I do in my world, I do for you. Which means for good or for bad. If people die in Russia, it has to do with us. People die in the United States, it has to do with us. Problems in Israel has to do with us. What's the connection? Everything is to wake us up. This is the word of the Gemara. But we don't seem to learn. 2,000 years is a repeat. This time... Now, we have to, each one of us has to know one thing. The situation, I'm telling you, is going to get worse and worse and worse and worse. We don't know how worse it can get, because we don't really know how to assume things like this. It's going to get worse. For us, as Jews, we are in the highest danger. The highest danger. Why? Because the nations are born with automatically with anti-Semitism. It's in their genes. Always it was like this. When this anti-Semitism comes out, when the Goyim makes a lot of money and they celebrate and they go to their baseball game and they have enough for their hot dogs and for nice cars and vacations and everything, they hate you, but they're not going to risk their good life to shoot you or to go to jail for you or to burn your house. Not yet. But when a situation comes that they don't make any money, what do you think is going to happen? The next thing, you're going to go to 42nd Street, one guy is going to start screaming, "The Jews did it to us. All the banks are going down because all of them, look," he's going to start giving names. AIG, an Israeli president. This Mary Lynch, Jew. He's going to start giving you hundreds of names. Greenspan, that brought all this to us, a Jew. Bernanke, Jew. This guy, Jew. The advisor of Obama, Jew. This, the next one, the assistants of Obama now, the White House. It's going to drive them crazy. It's going to go on the news. It's going to go on the internet. They chat. It's happening right now, by the way. In the internet, millions of messages are transferred every day against the Jews. Millions. In Fox News, in CNN, people making comments on articles. They clean it. They have people that clean it. They first read, they review it, and it's not a proper message, they don't publish. But they miss a lot of the bad messages. Some of them are lazy, they don't want to read everything. Some of them, they read only the beginning. They don't read in the end because it's very long. And they publish it. And then later they get complaints from Jews, so they take it off. So that's how it is. What do you think? It could be either the presidents make all kinds of bad decisions that the Jews will have to leave the country, like it's happened many, many times. It happens in Iran. One day, the Jews in Iran, a lot of you are from Iran, or your parents, you know better than me. Some of your parents, I know one guy lives in New Jersey, he owned a whole street in Iran, buildings, stores, everything. They took everything away from him. He had 24 hours to live. Everything he lost. Think about it. He worked for 30, 40 years. His father started everything. One day they knock on his door, "Mr. X, you have 24 hours. If you leave, leave everything here and leave. Take a bag or two, 24 hours to leave. Go to France, go anywhere you want. Cannot take anything with you. You don't do it, we arrest you." Why? Drug dealing. Go prove you're not a drug dealer now. What are you going to do? Go prove now. Betraying the country. We're listening to your phone calls. We check that you're a spy. Something, to make up something. They make the situation here so bad that you don't want to be here. You're not going to want to be here. Forget if they kick you or not. You yourself are not going to want to be here. Then where are you going to go? You want to run away to Israel? Didn't you read the prophecies, what's going to happen in Israel before Mashiach comes? Read Zechariah 14, see what it says over there. So what's the point here? It's interesting. In less than few months, Hashem showed us, you're not going to be able to run away from me. I've been waiting for you patiently for the Shabbat, for the modesty, for not stealing, for not cheating, for proper dress, for all these things that the Torah say. I've been waiting. 3,320 years I've been waiting. Now, the salvation has to start one way or the other. You don't want to do it in a nice way? Fine. What's going to be? We'll force you to do it. What's going to be? I'll create a situation in the world that you will realize you have nowhere to run. You're going to stand, people will start standing in the street and cry and scream to God, "Save me, have mercy on us." Those people a year ago, sitting with cigars in their offices, counting billions of dollars, when you speak to them about God, "God, don't talk about him in my office. We're not interested here. Hashem, what is this? Don't talk about religion in this office. You want to work here? Hey, mister, here, no politics, no religion." The same people will scream, "God, save me." That's what's going to happen. It's a prophecy. I didn't make it up. Hashem said, "I'm going to bring everyone who's on his knees to scream." That's what we say in the davening. Every davening, what do we finish with? "V'haya b'yom ahu yeh Hashem echad u'shmo echad." And at that day, everyone will say, "There's only one God." Everything is clear. One name, one God. It's not going to be Hashem, God, all kinds of names that the Goyim make. One name, Hashem. Everyone will scream to Hashem. That's besides the atomic risk in Iran and Pakistan and all the other problems that we have around us. Financially, you know, you don't even need wars. Financially, people don't have what to eat. What happened to them? Crime goes up, danger, violence, depression. That's the situation. So now, since we know that Hashem is very angry, we have two choices: to continue to be cold and sleeping and numb. There's time, and then it's going to be really too late for us as individuals. As a nation, it could be already too late for us. We are paying the price now. But as an individual, you're still alive. You're still walking. You're still breathing. You're still able to drive. You're still able to eat. No doctors, no hospital, no medicine, no machine. It's a miracle already. Don't take a risk. Don't play with fire. Why? When there is time of anger in the world, everyone gets hurt. The Torah says, we read it in Yom Kippur, Maftir Yonah. It's the most expensive aliyah of Yom Kippur. People pay fortune for it. What? It's in the Mincha of Yom Kippur. Just before the Ne'ilah star, the most important prayer of the year, we read the entire 3 or 4 pages of Maftir Yonah, Haftarah. What's the story over there? Why we read it in Yom Kippur? Because this is one of the classical, famous story of repentance of a nation. Where do you get a chance to see that an entire nation made tshuva? Where? Imagine you come now to Israel, you scream, the rabbi scream, I'm begging you. Members of the Knesset, members of the army, screams on television, on a newspaper, in interview, working in the street, screaming. What's going to happen after 2 minutes? They put him in jail. You're disturbing us. Hashem sent a Jewish prophet to a country, a city of Goyim, Nineveh. Millions of Goyim there. He told them, Hashem told me to tell you, in 40 days, He will destroy all of you. Who knows, 1 million, 5 million, we don't really know the numbers. They're a very big place. They had a king, it's a country. They have a king, he comes to the king. Hello, my name is Yonah, Ben Amitai, a Jew. Comes to, imagine he goes now to Pakistan or somewhere. Hashem sent me to tell you, you have 40 days before He clean you from the face of the earth. What's the chances a country would listen to a Jew? A rabbi comes and knock. Excuse me, God sent me to warn you. 40 days, they'll make a puppet show on him. Remember that Jew that came yesterday, right? But that's what happened. He went to them and he said, in 40 days, everything will be over. So what happened? They all wore sacks. They put ashes on their head. They started to fast. No food. Everyone. All the goyim. They sat on the streets like the Jews did in Iran. In the time of Haman, 3 days, everyone came out, the kids, the women, out of the yeshivot, they all sat in the middle of the Shushan Abira and all fasted and screamed to Hashem. That's where we have a fast of Esther. As a memory of this, the miracle followed right after. So they all made repentance, the goyim, for those 40 days. Then the prophet came back to them and he said, you all got saved. What? Ki ra'a Hashem et ma'asechem. Because God witnessed your good deeds. He didn't say, God saw your fasting. It's impressive, they fast every day. What? He didn't say, He saw the sacks that you wore. He didn't say, He saw the ashes you put on your head. He did not say, He saw that you left work and business and nobody cared anymore about making money, losing money, everybody sat together and cried. I didn't say. What did He say? That you change your bad deeds. You used to be a thief, you stopped stealing. You used to do this, sex crimes, you stopped. You were obnoxious to your wife, you stopped. That's what happened to them. Why God wanted to destroy them? They didn't have to keep Shabbat, this goyim. Well, how much they had to do, this goyim? They had to keep 7 laws, which most of them anyway they keep. You should not kill. It's a law in every country. Well, we have to assume that in Nineveh, there was against the law to kill, right? To eat raw animal, most likely they wouldn't do it. To obey the police and the court system, probably most people did. What was their sins of this goyim that God wanted to erase millions of them in one shot? Probably, maybe worship idols, maybe. And sex crimes. That's the only two possibilities. Because that's against the 7 laws of Noah. You know, There's one thing in the Torah that Jews refuse to accept. It bothers them very much. It wasn't only from today, it's throughout history. Jews refuse to accept. Not the ordinary people. The rabbis, they are afraid of the opinion of the majority of the people, so they're also biased. They're not objective. When they come, they're afraid to tell the people the truth of the Torah. How many rabbis you see in the world, between you and me, that will dare to give a lecture like I'm giving here today? I'm risking my life. Tomorrow, who knows who's going to call me? What are you doing? Why are you telling the people all these things? You have to relax them. You have to make them go sleep happy, smiling. Don't tell them about all these things. But this is against the Torah. You see, if the Torah wouldn't say it so clear in so many places, then you're right. Why people should get people scared? Why I should come to tell a person, did you know that by not keeping Shabbat, every second that you live is a miracle? You have already hundreds and thousands of death sentences are hanging against you, files in heaven, that eventually will have to pay for each one of them. It's not only one death. You're going to have to be revived and die perhaps millions of times. For every time you smoke a cigarette on Shabbat, you have a punishment hanging against you. If I come and tell it to a person, what is he going to say? Oof, religion is so bad. This rabbi is crazy. Come on, leave me alone. I am happy with my wife. I'm giving tzedakah. I come to shul sometimes, rabbi. Enough. It's not for me. It's not for this generation. We don't want another Iran here. You know, I'm telling you all the comments that people give. But I have one advantage on you, that I can bring up the Torah and read it from the Torah. You cannot. Those who make excuses against what I say, don't say it. You're not allowed to say it. Don't scare me. I don't want to hear it. You're putting us under stress, pressure. Everything is beautiful. Do you have something to back you up? No, I have a lot of places to back me up. What did the Torah say? I'll give you an example. The Torah said that the Jews came to God and they wanted a king. God didn't want them to have a king. He wanted to be their own direct king. But the Jews always want something real. Rabbi, I want to see the results now. I give tzedakah. I want to make business. I want to make money. What, I'm giving tzedakah? You tell me one day you'll be rich. Now! Believe me, if I win the lottery, I'll give half of it to the yeshiva. What do you think? When you win the lottery, you won't give a penny to the yeshiva. That's usually how it is. But forget it. Besides the point. So the Jews wanted somebody to see. Give us a king. We want to see a king, President Obama. We want him to give us nice speeches. I have a dream. We can make a change. People want. You see how they scream. They go. They leave work. People. This is the nature of the people. So Hashem said, no problem. We'll give you a king. Then comes the Torah and give us a list of orders and instructions how a king should be and how the relationship of the king and the people should be. So here is the list. One, the king should not have a lot of horses. If the Torah was given today, in this generation, so then it would say the king is not allowed to have many cars. Same idea, because horse used to be their car. He needs few horses for himself, that's it. Don't gather Arab horse, Persian horse, Japanese horse, whatever. They have horses that are worth millions of dollars, you know. In England, they announced yesterday that the rich British, most of them cannot pay for the expenses of the horses. That's what they say in England. I don't really know how much it costs to have a horse. Perhaps it costs a lot of money to maintain a horse. You need a trainer, you need a place to put him, doctors, because these horses worth millions. They go to races, you know. But the king used to gather a lot of horses. So Hashem said, I'm not interested you have a lot of horses. Then, not a lot of women. Few wives. A man is allowed, according to Torah, more than one wife. It's not the law in the last 1,000 years. No Jews marry more than one wife. But it used to be marriage used to be a holy institution. People did it really for the truth of the Torah and God and for the purpose of having children and raising them. And there was no jealousy like today between one wife to another. People were holier. That's why it was realistic. 1,000 years ago already, it wasn't realistic. So the rabbis made a decree. That's it. It's irrelevant anymore. But That's before all the human rights, the women rights organization came into place and the wives all became the bosses, you know. Every store you go, you want to sell them a product in a store. So you fill up the application, you make the sale, you convince the owner, you're happy, oh, finally I make $1,000 commission after such a bad month. Everything is signed, the check is ready. Okay, let me just see that my wife approves it. Always the wife, 99% of the time, John, come on. How come you didn't ask me? No, I think we should wait. The wife's controlling. Sometimes it's better, because the husband is so foolish, it's better his wife gonna watch what he does. But the Torah say, a man is a man of the house, he's the boss of the house. Some of the things, let's say the wife wants to paint the walls yellow. He doesn't like yellow. No, I don't want. It's the wife word. Why? She's in the house, you're not there. Most of the time she's there. She wants furniture, she wants pink couch. I hate pink. You like pink, you're happy, no problem. You want Persian rug red, you want black, you want brown, whatever you want, it's your call. You want a car, I can afford to buy my wife a car, what color you want, no problem, it's your choice. But there are things in the house, the last word about the education of the kids, the last word about the money. Even if the wife makes 99.9% of the money, the Torah says the husband is the boss on the money. That's what the Torah says. Now the women that will hear me on their website will get very angry. I just want to remind you that I didn't make that law. The creator of the world and the creator of men and women knows better than us a little bit. A little bit better. And he said the man has to be the boss of the money. Why? Because if the man is not in charge of the money, his image in the eyes of his wife is very low. And she disrespects him. But when a man is the boss in the house, the women give him respect and the house have harmony. Doesn't mean he doesn't have to give her gifts and nice attention and helping out. You know, there's a whole list. We gave a whole lecture about this once. But, going back to the king. So the king is not allowed to have too many wives. He's not allowed to accumulate gold and silver and money like Saddam did and the Iranian Shah. Each one of them died with $40 billion in his accounts, and that's what they caught. Gold faucets, diamond chandeliers, not crystal, diamond chandelier, 7 palaces Saddam had. That's what they caught. Who knows? Arafat. Nobody knows until today where he hid all his billions that he stole from his nation. All the money that they got from Europe and this, all of that used to steal. Now who took it? The Swiss banks. Because it goes by number. What do you think they did to all the Jews after the Holocaust? If they gave the Jews hundreds of millions of dollars compensation, just imagine how much they took. Right? Think about it. If a person is a crook, a lawyer, let's say, and a person that had $1 billion in a safe deposit somewhere in a place, and the only person in the world knew about it is his lawyer. Nobody knew. He's trusted him all these years. One day before he died, the lawyer comes to visit him in the hospital. He says, hey, I just want to tell you, make sure that you give this $1 billion to my son, X. Lawyer says, yeah, sure, don't worry, Moshe. 100%. Feel good. Everything you tell me, I'm going to do right away. As soon as he died, he takes everything to himself. Let's say he's conscious bothered him a little bit. You want to give this Moshe something. I mean, the son of this guy, Moshe, son. How much you would give him from the billion? 10%, you're dreaming. Moshe, your father left you $350. Come get it. If they offer hundreds of millions, just imagine how many billions they took. Think about it. All the German Jews were very wealthy, like in America today. There's a lot of wealthy Jews here. And where are they hiding all the money that they didn't pay the IRS? Overseas banks, you know. What do you think, they're going to put it here? Here, any second the IRS wants to go into your account, they take everything. They leave you $5,000 to live for a few months until you try. In 1 second, it's all frozen. You have no idea. I mean, the IRS and the immigration is above any other institution. They have power in the court they are stronger than the court. Usually in a democracy, you have a court, Supreme Court, the police cannot do whatever they want, the FBI, they need a warrant, they need a judge. There's a system here, supposedly. Immigration, there's nobody to talk to. They put you in jail for 1 year, no tefillin, no kosher food in Pennsylvania. You have to beg them to get a visit. You feel no rights, nothing. There's nothing you can do with them, unless if you know someone inside that can go. One lawyer told me, I would take away your money, we wanted to release a guy, but I feel bad for you. My chances to release the guy is less than zero. And please don't give money to any other lawyer, because he cannot do anything I cannot do. I promise you, no one. So in the future, remember, if one illegal immigrant, relative of yours, got arrested, and lawyers promising you give me $10,000, $15,000 to save him, remember, don't give him a penny, he cannot do anything with the money. And I'll tell you a lot of stories. They cannot do anything. That's how they made it. So the Torah said to the king, don't gather, don't collect too much money. If you have extra money, a lot of money, you got to give it out. You're not allowed to be extra wealthy. You have whatever you need, fine. No, we're not telling you to be a beggar, yeah, a king. But it's against the Torah. That means if a king put millions of dollars in all kinds of banks, if we had a king today in the nation of Israel, it's like eating pork every second. Every time he makes a deposit, which is more than the amount he's allowed, it's like eating pork, it's like not putting tefillin, it's like violating Shabbat, same thing. And the worst thing is what? And he has to have a Sefer Torah written in his hands, and he has to take it everywhere he goes with him. He goes to the war, he takes it with him. He goes to a wedding, he has a Sefer Torah with him. Everywhere he goes, he has to take the Sefer Torah. Why? What's the next sentence that comes after that? That he should learn how to fear me. That's the words of the Torah. When you hold the Sefer Torah, you get goosebumps. Even if you hate religion. They come to shul once in a while to a bar mitzvah. You see how the non-religious people always come to the Sefer Torah and hold like the Western world, like this for half an hour? Why are you standing by the Torah? You just ate a rabbit for breakfast and shrimps for lunch. Why you come now to the Torah? You don't care about the Torah. One time a guy came to me for Shabbat. And I saw after the davening for 5 minutes he's holding like this the ark of the Sefer Torah. He's like touching his face to the for 5 minutes. I saw he's like excited. So I asked him, "Did you hear the scream?" He says, "Scream? No, it's quiet here." Everyone already left after the shul, Shabbat morning. I say, "You don't hear the screaming? Echo, scream." He say, "No." I say, "I just hear the big, huge shouting. What is it?" "Don't kiss me. Listen to me. Don't kiss me. Listen to me. Listen to me. Listen to me. Don't kiss me." So he still didn't catch the guy. So what do you mean? I said, "The Torah was screaming, don't make me favors, please. Come, you kiss, yeah, no problem. Instead of all these kisses, just listen to me. You put tefillin today, tomorrow, put tefillin. You hit your wife yesterday, make sure it's the last time you ever did it. You're stealing from your customers, stop right away. Begin to return. You did this, you did that. That's what Hashem wants from you. What Hashem wants you to stand like this all day in Ritilim. It's important to praise Hashem here and there. I'm not saying no. But Hashem didn't say that to the people of Nineveh, oh, you fasted, you did this. No, I'm happy with you change your bad things, your bad behaving. That's why none of you will die. A month ago, all of you were dead people. I give you your life back. Who knows how long they live. So, the Torah said to the king that he should learn, Leman ilmad liraoti, that he should learn how to fear me. Why Hashem is so anxious that we will fear him? Why? If you fear me, you would listen to me good. If you don't fear me, you disrespect me. You know those stupid kids that get arrested? How they treat the cops, they curse them, they throw things at them. They're stupid. Later they're going to get into million times more. They could have gone to jail 24 hours and be out with $500 bail and the story is over. But since he did something to the cop and this, now he's going to have to be 2 months in jail. Why? Because he's a fool. He doesn't see, he thinks he's a big shot in front of his friends. I, in my eyes, saw in Main Street, and 73rd, there's a big supermarket over there, near the theater there. I saw 4 guys, Jewish, but oy lanu from such Jews, how they looked. All kinds of chains. I don't know, maybe they've been in Puerto Rico for 2 years. I don't really know where they learn how to, and they smoke, who knows what they smoke. I saw a police stopping at the light there in a corner, and I saw one of them throwing the cigarette on the floor. So the cop told him, pick it up, put it in the garbage. Now, if you be a person that did that, and a cop tells you that, let's say you are a billionaire, and this cop is nothing. Who is he compared to you? You can buy this cop 100 times. You can do whatever you want to him. Fine. Right now, he told you, pick up the cigarette and put it in the garbage. What would you do? A normal person say, excuse me, you're right, pick it up, put it in the garbage, let the story over. What? Go now to get arrested, to call my lawyer, what for? The guy tell him, no, I'm not going to pick it up. Then there's a woman there in the back. He told you to pick up the cigarette. I'm not going to pick it up. What, are you in charge of cleaning the streets now? It's against the law, what, you're going to arrest me? So the other guy tells him, hey, in Hebrew, he tells him, pick it up, you fool. So, no, they're not going to tell me what to do. He didn't pick it up. The cop was busy, I guess, because usually they also have their pride, you know. Something like this would end in a very bad situation. But he went and picked it up. Why did it happen? The guy has no fear from the cop. When you don't have a fear, of course you're not going to respect him. If you're scared from him, you respect him. You have no choice. You respect him. For every second of respect you give him, you're earning a lot. So what was the whole idea of fearing him? That he should give you eternity of pleasure. Because the Torah says, I'm faithful to pay reward. A father that is tough with his children, when he comes home, they stop with their nonsense right away. It's good, no? What's better, a puppet that comes home and his children call him, hey, Itzik. In Israel, it's a new fashion now. People don't call their parents dad or Abba anymore. It's a new style now. Hey, Yankale, Moshe. Did you park the car close that I don't have to go 1 block away? Of course, he doesn't ask him if he needs the car or not. Where did you put the key? No, I have to go. I have a meeting. All right, so take a cab. That's how it is today, new generation. When I was a kid, an old man got on a bus, everyone rise, fighting with him. Come, please sit here. No, sit here, appointment woman, right away. As soon as she got on the bus, you already have 7, 8 people standing. Where is she going to choose to sit? Or the old man. Today, hey, grandpa, get up, I'm tired. Exactly like this, it's not a joke. It's exactly like this. Where? In the country of God, the Holy Land. Not to talk about Harlem and who knows, East New York and I don't know where, Chicago, whatever. All these gangster neighborhoods. So, one rabbi told me, Hashem is already disgusted with his world. What do you expect? How long is he going to be able to see? You don't see, I don't see 1/1,000,000,000% from what's happening here every night. But God sees everything. He's fed up with it. How many cheating is going to be able to see every night? How many forbidden sex crimes? How much stealing? How much gossip? How much? How much a person can stand? How much God can stand? The reaction comes. Now remember, before we finish, and I give you some time for questions if you want, it's a very, very high level. The Ramchal said that a Jew reach a point that is really fear God. I'm not saying to sit home and scared not to move. No, that's not what he wants. Fear means you think twice before you curse. You think twice before you speak Lashon Hara, gossip about another person. You think 10 times before you steal a penny. You think a lot before you do something against your family. You think a million times before you clean the stain from your tie or put your clothes in the laundry on Shabbat or lighting a cigarette. Things that people do today, talking on the phone, watching television, don't even think twice. When Yom Kippur comes, you really, really feel bad. You regret. You're disappointed. You're embarrassed. You think in your heart, I wish I would be able to go back to last Yom Kippur and do the entire year differently. Today, Rabbi, Yom Kippur, we bought steak. You want to come with us? Come, we're doing barbecue on Yom Kippur. And they also rent videos in advance, you know. They don't want to stand online. Erev Yom Kippur, you know how long is the lines in the video places? Like they don't have 200 channels on their televisions. But they want to make sure they have a good movie. That's not fear. That's no fear. Today in Israel, every Israeli boy or girl younger than 20 years old has a very high percent that is not a Jew. You'll never know it already. It's too late to know. His grandparents from Russia or from other countries that they came to Israel 20, 30 years ago, or they never came to Israel. The grandparents that were goyim, their children were goyim, but they came from Russia 15, 20 years ago. And their children are what? Goyim completely. Sometimes I hear on the news that somebody, I'll just give you an example. Yesterday in Israel, they convicted a guy, they gave him 13 years in prison. What did he do? He broke into an old woman house, 75 years old, something like this she looks like, with another four guys. They tied her, robbed her house completely, but it wasn't enough. They wanted to enjoy now. Stealing, you can find excuses. They need drugs, they can't control it. They broke, their parents don't have a penny, they wanted to buy something. So they didn't care, old person, let's steal his money. No! It's a tragedy, it's terrible. No! It's not, there are worse things than this. But guess what they did after they took all the money? They took their cigarettes and started to make holes in her body. Burning her with the cigarettes. Enjoying, laughing. She's screaming, the old woman. Yesterday she sat in a court in Israel facing this guy. So they interview him. I saw on the news, they interview the guy. As soon as I saw him, before I knew the case, the guy that was sitting next to me, I told him this is a goy. Later they display his name, a Russian Amalek. A Jew will burn cigarettes and an old Jewish woman. If that's going to happen, then for sure Hashem is not going to keep this world one more minute. Amalek! Amalek, who is these Russians? This is the Amalek that Hashem said to destroy it from the face of the earth. What do you think? Everything in the world, they are behind the scene. Wars, Arab, weapon to the Syrians, nuclear to the Iranians. Who is behind every bad things in this world? Russia. What's the word Russia means in Hebrew? Rasha, evil, wicked. Russia. How do they call them? Russia. It's not a coincidence that they made their name Russia. Rasha, what's in Hebrew Rasha means? Rasha! Torah said, don't be Rasha. Amalek. You saw the Georgian made a little muscle. The Georgians. 1 week, they wiped them out. They don't care. The Israelis, they worry about some Palestinian kids. Right away. So the Torah say, Le'ahava, yes, you should love me. But it's not less important to fear me. לאהבה ולהיראה את השם הגדול הנורא הנכבד הזה, את השם אלוקיך. To fear this great, huge, I don't really know the right words in English. השם הנורא is the greatest, or the huge, or the tremendous. Oh, that's really the right word. The tremendous great God. People think sometimes, you know, God... We are buddies. We went to college together. Well, we were roommates. What? Maybe the psychology tells them, oh, I'm okay, Rabbi. Really, you mean that God wanted me to be like this? Literally? He wanted me to, on Shabbat, not to watch basketball games? That's what he cares about? Yes! Yes! Clear! What? Read! Don't create any fire, no energy, no electric, no driving, no cigarettes, none of that. It's very important. The punishment is unbelievable. The punishment. Forget about that a person should be clever enough. How can I be grateful to my creator? That's besides the point of the punishment. Even if there's no punishment in the Torah, a clever person that knows God gave him oxygen, everything he owned, everything he got in his life was all from him. So many people are in hospitals. They cannot walk. They cannot eat. I'm alive. I have clothes. I have a nice house. I have a swimming pool. I dream. I sweat. I have great life. So I'm married. I have children. I have food. Whatever. You can always look at the negative, of course, and be depressed. But you achieved a lot. So remember, everything you have, he gave you. What do you do with that? Take it and use it against him. Maybe not intentionally, but that's reality. Let's go back to the last 67 years of your life. Review it. You're not going to know where to hide yourself from the embarrassment. Because remember, over there it's going to be clear. I gave you this $1 million in a deal. The deal was dead. I made this guy be sick. He didn't come to the meeting. They sent somebody else. You signed the deal. With the other person, he wouldn't make the deal. Let's see what you did with the $1 million that I gave you. Let's see. 5 tons pork. 500 hours driving on Shabbat with this money. 200,000 from that, show off on the street with your convertible Mercedes everywhere you go. The Nazi puts your grandfather in the oven, this Mercedes company, and you go and pay the money as a thank you card. Thank you, Mercedes, for help for killing all our grandfathers. Number one customers of BMW and Mercedes, the grandsons of the Jewish victim. Well, of course, who's going to buy it? You understand? Lexus is not good enough, Rabbi. You don't understand. It's very good, but it's not a hundred. It's not a Mercedes. Bottom line, Rabbi, it doesn't feel the same. That's the mind of a person. So Hashem is going to review everything he gave you, and let's see what you did with that. Imagine the embarrassment. Where are we going to? Wow! You're going to die. When this film is going to be over? It's a film that takes 70 years. Second by second. And over there, there's no baloney. Your Honor, I was sick that day. Right away, you're going to hear, liar, liar. Let's see where you were. All the story you tell your wife. Honey, there's so much work in the office. Right away, liar. You went to drink with friends and to play a dirty bar. Everything will be shown. And you know what's the worst part? All the people that you lie to, they will come to see it. Boss, I cannot come today to work. I don't feel good. You know, my head is pounding. Oh, now they go back to that date. They show the boss where you were. Headache. Not that he's better than you. He has his own file. That's how it works. That's what the Zohar says. Marim lo la'adam kol ma shelo yachal lirot b'chayav. A person will see everything he could not see in his life. Everything. That means that's included. So Hashem is going to tell you, I gave you all this. You couldn't think without the Torah. Forget about it. A goy and Ahmed. God will ask him the same question. Dear Ahmed, everything you had, who gave you? Allah, you gave me. What did you do with that? You did this, you did that. It's without Torah, without religion. Needless to say that you have instructions, what to do, what not to do, then you really have a problem. The Constitution was in your hand all along. I have a friend, I can tell you his name, that you don't think I'm telling you stories. His name is Wagner. He's a good friend of mine. He has a lot of books. He gives me books. A lot of the things I speak in my lecture, I learn from his books. He's my personal library. I don't have to go to a crowd library. You have a book about this subject, 18 books, the next day in my house. You don't know where to start. So this person, his wife is a doctor. She takes care of kids, you know. In the older days, before they moved to Muncie, they used to live in Brooklyn. And he used to have a friend, a rabbi, friend, that he was actually his first rabbi that taught him Torah. So that rabbi, also, he became friendly with him. So you know what it is, a young doctor, he was in yeshiva, was learning in yeshiva many years ago when he was young. So from time to time they needed loans, you know, business need loans. So you want to go now to the bank, it will take you a year to get a loan. He used to call him, Rabbi, I need X amount of money. Come tomorrow, you have it ready for you. Next week, I need this. He used to take and pay it back, take and pay it back. No problem. One time, they were mamash struggling financially, and he owed him $20,000, and the due date arrived. Now you know, you have a person like this, you are very nervous not to pay on time, because it's not a bank that they don't know who you are. So you tell them, I'm sorry, I cannot pay on time. Charge you penalty and interest, and it's the end of the story. It's a personal relationship. So Rebbe, your friend, he helped you a lot, you feel gratitude to him. So he called him up, he said, Rabbi, I'm sorry, you know, I'm running a little bit late, I need 30 days extension. Rabbi said, no problem. 30 days later, he owed him $20,000, the morning arrived, he doesn't have a dollar. He cannot sleep at night, he walk around, what am I going to do, where am I going to get the money? He told us this story 2 days ago. Then he goes to a place, a parking lot, next to his wife's office, stand outside in the parking lot. He see a black man with a suit and a tie, very tall guy, look like a basketball player, comes with a briefcase. Are you Mr. Wagner? Yes, can I help you? I got very good news for you today. Well, very good news, what could be the news? Say, yeah, well, say, I got here a check for you from Blue Cross Blue Shield Insurance Company. You see, when your wife joined them, she's a doctor. First year, they take 10% from every bill that they have to send to the doctors. They put in an escrow because they want to see how reliable is this doctor. After 1 year, if there's no complaints from patients and other people, no fraud, no problems, then they put this doctor in a good list that is not in a trial base anymore. And they take all the money that they put in escrow and they send it to him. So I have the check for you. Today your year is expired. He gets out of his briefcase a check, company check, $19,600. He's all day he's working. I owe the rabbi $20,000. That day, he didn't even know they take 10% from the bills. They didn't even know. Took it out for 1 year. The guy gave him the check, $19,600. Can you believe such a thing? That moment he told his wife, I just have news for you. We owe 20,000, he should know even. We owe him 20,000. In a moment he got it. Now, Hashem is doing a lot of miracles like this for us. Sometimes a person is very upset. Oof, I lost $1 million in a market, Rabbi. I'm very depressed. Don't talk to me about sponsoring CDs, please. I know it's important, but you know, I'm not in a good mood. Come back in 5 years when the mood will be good. Anyway. So, the idea is that this guy that just lost all this money forgot one important detail. That God already wanted to give him X amount of pain in his heart. 5 kilo, 10 pounds of pain. Each person needs different weight of the pain. One guy, 1 pound of pain is already broken. He cannot move, he's depressed, he's in bed. One guy, you have to put a ton of pain in his heart until he really begins to feel it. Because he's optimistic, he's not worried, he's a happy guy. He needs a lot of pain to move him. The other guy, he missed the bus, he's already crying. They didn't get him on a plane. He smoked a pack of cigarettes, cursing the whole world. Depend on the people, right? This guy that just lost the money forgot that because Hashem wanted to give him this pain, he was forced to give him the $1 million first. He really never deserved it. The whole idea was to give it to him to get to the point that he has to lose it. How is he going to get the pain? He knows this guy is stingy, is addicted to money, he will kill for money. It's money, money, everywhere he goes, he's thinking money, buy, build, double my money, how am I making, how much interest he check, every penny, every bill. A guy like this, if the food wasn't so delicious, he lives with that. Even if his baseball team lost, no, he can still live. If his wife cheated on him, no, it's not the end of the world. As long as I have $20 million in my account, I'm okay, Rabbi. I know, you know, come on, it's upsetting, but some one person, if he knows his wife cheated on him, he'll kill himself. He won't be able to live another second. Kill her and him, both of them. Some people, honey, I forgive you. So what a nice gentleman my husband is. He doesn't know he has 20 like her on the side. It's all, let's have an open marriage, Rava. It's in style now. We have an open, one guy came to me and said, I have an open marriage with my wife. She goes with whoever she wants. I'm not asking questions. I go with whoever I want. And I say, what about the kids? You know, the kids grew into it. They learn how to respect us. You understand where we're going here? Sodom and Gomorrah, you understand? Yeah. This is right here. And I'm not telling you other things. They publish in the internet. You want to exchange wives for 30 days? They put in the internet. Goyim, Jews, dirty people, low lives. The worst part is that they don't know that they are in a level of, I don't want to say who, the biggest low life in history, in the eyes of God. Because if a person is having relation with a married woman, is nothing better than the worst enemies that we can imagine. I don't want to say names, not to hurt people. But he's in a very, very low situation in front of God. Now you may say, but business is booming. Now nobody can say it anymore. But in the old days, business is booming. Yes, it's moment before your final eternal destruction. So for the few mitzvot that you made in your life, you are getting paid right now. We spoke about it. It's in the end of Parashat Va'etchanan, paying the wicked cash to get rid of them. Don't leave any open bills before they come to me. Why? I'm not gonna let them enter heaven. They have no world to come. So what do you want? They have 20, 30 years here to live, to enjoy, supposedly, for the good that they did. Charity, fasted on Yom Kippur, once in their life they did Kiddush. They did a few good things in their life. I owe them. Where would I pay them? There I don't want them with me. So I got to pay them here. And that's what they want anyway. That's their dream. They want to have a fancy car. They want to have a fancy house. They want vacations every 2 days. That's what they're dreaming about. That's what I'm paying them with. I wouldn't dream to get a vacation. You come, you tell me here, I give you my house, the nicest suite in the world. Take it free of charge. I pay the airlines, I pay the ticket, you have whatever you want. I would think to myself to waste a month to go to that place for what? To see the chandeliers, to see the rugs, to see the Picasso pictures. These things stopped exciting me a long, long time ago. It's mamash a punishment to go to a place like this. I'm not talking about to carry all the suitcases and you have to take the kids and this and elevator and the taxi and raining and this. So vacation is a big headache. What for in the end? To sit on a beach somewhere in Mexico. Go to Brooklyn, sit on a beach if you love the beach so much. The reality, the mind of the people, why is so anxious to go to Cancun? Why? Because everybody, all the big shots surrounding are speaking about it. He want to be able to put in his resume, I was in Cancun, I was in Acapulco, I was in St. Martin, I'm going to Tel Aviv 3 times a year, Rabbi. We're having vacations, you know. I have a vacation house everywhere I go. I don't like hotels. So I bought one in Miami. I have in Tel Aviv. I have in Jerusalem. I have in Paris. I have this. There are people like this. Then they come to Hashem. Hashem, yes, everything you had was a payment. Now I owe you nothing. Then he's going to start screaming, what? Who wants these houses? If I knew those houses are payments before you getting rid of me, I'll never agree to accept it. It's too late. I want to finish with the last word. Yeah, the lecture could be strong. It can make people think, it can make people scared. Very good. Very positive. The doctor just told you, you have very high cholesterol. You have diabetes. You have this, you have that. You need a surgery, you need a treatment, you need MRI. So much bad news in one visit, doctor! The doctor has to tell you like this. I love you very much. You're my patient for many years. I care for you. What do you think? I can tell you everything is okay. What do I care? Everything okay, be fine. I care for you, that's why I give you all the bad news. I only tell you the real situation. The situation of the world, you didn't need me to tell you how it is. Maybe some of you didn't see where it's heading to. You still have, you're still optimistic, you think everything will be fine, forget about it. It will be a million times worse. Prepare already. Leave cash in the house, don't put too much money in banks. Soon the government will not have enough to pay for the FDIC. So far, few cases, the FDIC cover, because they had trillions of dollars on their special for those kind of incidents. But God forbid, when a bank like Chase will go down, they won't have enough money. It's the biggest bank in America, Chase, Bank of America, Citibank. Where are they going to bring all this money to pay for all the people? If they have to pay $250,000 for each saving account, where are they going to bring it from? They're printed. So that means your dollar will worth nothing. You would like to buy a car that costs right now $40,000, German car, let's say. So now you're going to have to pay $140,000 for this car because the dollar is worth nothing. Either way you lose. You lose it from your bank account because it's gone. That's one way. The government will pay it to you. You lose it when you come to buy your next car. It's the same thing. Cannot win. It's a no-win situation. You cannot escape Hashem. That's it. So what's a clever guy say? If you can't beat him, join him. I cannot beat you, God. This is what you want. This is the way you made the world. You put me in a test. I hate it. But what can I do? I gotta be clever. I have to cooperate. You cooperate, you get something. You rebel, you get nothing. So you might as well take the opportunity to wake up. For those of you who hear me on the internet or in the past lectures and still didn't move into action, please, I'm begging you. Before it's going to be too late. When Mashiach comes, nobody can become Baal Tshuva anymore. No more converts are accepted. That's why halacha. Why? Of course. First one who would want to be a Jew is Obama. I have a dream. I just found out my purpose in life, to convert. Of course, he saw 2 hours ago the Mashiach just arrived in Yerushalayim. Everyone will want to be a Jew. The Arabs, they're going to scream, Allah, you really Akbar this time. We just found you, for real. Who do they scream to? It's the same God. They just think he gave them the Quran. They will wake up from their illusion. It's too late. The door is closed. To them and to Jews. Okay, Rabbi, now I'm ready. I'm willing to come keep Shabbat. Your invitation from 20 years ago is still open to come to your house for Shabbos? My invitation is. But Hashem's invitation is already closed out, finished. Why? Now you're a hero? Now you want to be a Baal Tshuva? Now you want to be righteous after you saw the truth? After now you see that everything the Torah says is happening? After you see they drop an atomic bomb, now you remember a lot of people now wants to become religious, Baruch Hashem. Why? They lost their job, they lost their business, nobody can get married now, unless if your father has a lot of money, nobody can get married. One of the reasons that we are in a situation that we are now, I said it in my previous lecture, because we spent millions of dollars with these foolish weddings that we made in the last 10 years here in America. If you calculate how much steaks, how many steaks, and fish, and fruit, and sushi, whatever they serve, how much goes to the garbage in every Jewish event, bris, wedding, bar mitzvah, how much goes in the end of every party, goes to the garbage, you're not going to believe what's going on here. One piece of fish is $10 in a store for Shabbos, one little piece. Thousands of pieces they throw to the garbage. Why? It was a $500,000 wedding. Who cares now? There's $10,000 left food. What are we going to do with that? What do you expect us to do with that? Call the yeshivot to come take it maybe? Maybe pay $100 for car service to pick up all the pens and give it to all the yeshivot in the area? $200-$300? It's worth to lose $300 to save $10,000 food, no? The yeshivot, some of them don't even have money for orange juice and milk. Most of them don't. And now it's going to be a lot worse. Nobody appreciates anything. $10,000 for suit. $500 for shoes. My husband is very wealthy. $100 million for a house. When you come to him, give us money. There's a lot of widows. their husband died, they have children are dying, they're going to bed hungry every night, business is bad. A week later you hear on the news, he just bought himself a house for $100 million. A real story. We cannot afford right now to take new tzedakah. A week later, $100 million for a house, a guy with a yarmulke. Now how do you expect us not to be in the situation that we are? What is this person going to say to Hashem? He comes to Hashem, he says, Hashem, hey, hundreds of people beg you to give them a few $1,000 every month to each one of them. Why did you say, no, we cannot, we already give enough. Let's see what you gave, let's see what you make. You made $2 billion this year in all your businesses. How much you gave? $20 million. Shame on you. I give $20 million. Nobody gives $20 million. No. You made $2 billion, you're giving me $20 million back. Why didn't you give me $1.9 billion and left yourself with $100 million for that year? It's enough for you, no? Why did I give you all this money? To buy houses? To pay $100 million on a house? You crazy? What are you, King David? King Solomon didn't live in a house like this. That's what happened to us. The pride drives us crazy. Some people don't wear the same suit twice, Rabbi. I never wore a suit twice in my life. I wear it once, I pass it to the servants. You understand? No, I know, maybe I'm speaking very high to your level. But you know at least the truth. Yeah, maybe you're far away from it. No, I don't expect you to be big philanthropers giving millions of dollars tzedakah. Hopefully you'll be able to afford it. No, that's not the purpose of this. I'm just giving you an example of what's going on around us here. My expectation from you is very simple. First thing, to keep Shabbat. Keep Shabbat. No driving, no electric, no television. Put timers, cook the food, put it on a hot tray. If you have a synagogue in your house, very nice. If the synagogue is very far, don't go to synagogue. Pray a little bit at home if you can, in your language, whatever. Be with the wife, with the kid, take a walk. No problem. Take some good books, sit, read, sleep. You know what? Sleep all Shabbat. No kiddush, no nothing. Just sleep. Don't use electric, don't smoke cigarettes. It's hard for you not to smoke. Get to bed, read something until very late Friday, and fall asleep until 5, 6 in the evening. You kept Shabbat. You didn't violate Shabbat. Very good. You already saved yourself from 60% of the tragedies. Right there, by keeping Shabbat. And then, if you have a problem that you're a thief, you steal, you cheat, buy some good books about faith in God and about living, a parnasa. It will help you a lot to stop. Because you realize all this money will go chas v'shalom to cancer in the end. You're not going to enjoy it. Nobody can enjoy something it's not his. It's against the law of God. You cannot win him. Can't change the constitution of God. You're not going to enjoy from it at all. If it's not going to go chas v'shalom for you, it's going to go for your bad problems of your children. You're going to suffer from all this money that you steal. It doesn't pay. Don't cheat, don't steal, clean. Rabbi, if I'm going to stop stealing, my business is going to go down from 1 million to 50,000 a year. It's better to be poor all your life than to steal $1. The Gemara says, a person better off be a fool on the street. You know these people that are homeless and they're crazy and they talk to themselves and the kids run after them and pull them in the back and they laugh at them and they go like, you know, these crazy people on the street, they sleep on their benches, they sleep under the stairs. There's a lot of poor, miserable people like this. The Torah, no, it's not my opinion. The Torah says it's better you be one of those all your life. And to be 1 hour wicked in front of Hashem. In all your... 1 hour! 1 hour you left the Torah. What about somebody all his life left the Torah? What's the comparison? What's the purpose of life? Ask yourself questions. Ask yourself questions. Look at these Iranians. Look at these Arabs. Learn from them a message. They live in a lie. They think the Quran is holy. It's nothing. People wrote it. Full of mistakes. Their cadis in a mask brainwash their heads from morning to night. They sell them tapes. They force them to go to kill themselves. They're willing to die to kill innocent people, thinking they're doing what God told them. It's all illusion, all nonsense. We that know for sure that we have the words of God. We are the only nation that received it in public. We ignore it. Therefore, their toilet paper willing to die. And we have the book of God and we ignore it? You gotta wake up. That's the truth. Be'ezrat Hashem, now when the situation is going to become more and more choking, the Torah says, "Batzar lecha," for those who understand Hebrew, "Umetzaucha kol hatzarot ha'ele, ושבת עד השם אלוקיך ושמעת בקולו." When I'm gonna choke you tighter and tighter, צר לך, נארו, everything is around you, ambush, I'm ambushing you, and all these tragedies and problems are accumulating to you, what's gonna be your solution? Repent, return from your bad way. And what's gonna be my reaction to you? I will forgive your sins and have mercy on you. Don't believe me, believe the Torah. It's not my words. Clear, simple Hebrew, English, Russian, Persian, whatever you want. Any book you open, it's the same words. Same translation. When I'm going to choke you, problems, business is not nothing, you cannot send one diamond, you cannot sell one rug, you don't have any more money to put gas in your Mercedes. Situation you've never been in before. Can't pay the mortgage, can't pay this, people owe you money, they don't pay you, you know. Very good. I'm choking you because I love you. If I'll give you more, one of the big rebbes, I think it was Rav Chaim Ibrisk, I'm not sure. He said, I had, my soul went up to heaven. My clinical death. And I heard an angel is screaming in front of God, God! Give more money to the Jews. You're not giving them enough. They need more money. Everything is expensive. Kosher food. They need this. They need that. They cannot work 7 days. You got to give them more money. So his student asked him, Rabbi, who was this angel? He said, the Satan. Why? He's very clever. The more money you will have, what's going to happen to you? You'll betray God more. Why? Why? That's what the Torah says. Shamanta, avita, kasita. You become heavier, heavier, heavier. What's going to be the outcome? Vaitosh Eloah. You forgot about your God. Yishamer lecha pen tishkach et Hashem Elokecha. Be very careful that you won't that you will forget me. And you're going to say where? In your heart. Not in your mouth. We say it clearly every day with our mouth. We're much worse than what the Torah spoke about. But the Torah said, be careful, that means do not think even in your head, in your heart, that everything you have is thanks to your talent, that you're a smart guy, that you're a talented guy. I'm the best painter, Rabbi. Look how much people pay me for a picture. When you hold the brush, everything from this moment on Hashem is doing for you. Who gives you the ideas? Who will help you to move your hand? Without me, you cannot move an inch. When you write a check, where does money come from? I send you the customer, so you have now money that you can do whatever you want. So the idea is, what happened to the people? What does the Torah say? Pen tomar bilvavcha kochi ve'otzem yadi asali et ha'chayil hazeh. It's thanks to my strength and my talent I have this success. What comes right after that? Don't even dare to think like this. You should put yourself down, you should be humble, and you remember. The fact that you live another minute is because Hashem is still waiting for you. The fact that it didn't take you 70 or 50 or 40 or 20 years ago, because He's still waiting for you. There will be a moment that He will not wait for you anymore. Then you scream, give me one more day. I'm begging you. Take everything I have. Take the millions. Take the billions. Give me one more day, a chance to correct. What do you think? Everyone who dies, they say it. What do you think they say? When they see what they're facing, I said, please, God, just one day, I promise you, yeah, I have $1 billion. No, I'm not going to give it to my children. Nothing. I promise you, take everything, put me back homeless on the street, give me one more day. What's the answer? I know people who died and came back to life, clinical death. They say, I have wife, children, I didn't finish, people owe me money, give me one more day to live and kill me. One more day to make some phone calls, to tell the lawyer, to tell I didn't write a will. What's the answer? They all say in their tapes, you're not the only one who have wives and children. It's not making any impression over there. What are you going to think when you come to God? Why are you killing me? I'm only 40. Don't you care? I have 6, 7 children. Who's going to take care of them? It's a joke. I didn't know that you have 6, 7 children before I took you. I didn't know. You don't think I thought about it a million times? What's going to be now from now on? I didn't take it to consideration before I made the verdict comes through. No, I didn't, huh? Now you're telling me that it needs to be done in a better way? You brought it to yourself. That's what the judges say in court. Everybody cried, judge, have mercy on my wife. They didn't do anything, my children. What's the answer of the judges? You should have thought about it before. They all say the same words. You should have thought about it before. Before you became a criminal or drug dealer. Didn't you think that one day you may get caught? There's a chance, no? You should have thought what's going to happen to your children. Smart criminals, they already worry about enough money to have to their family on different names than in case something goes wrong to them. But not all the criminals are smart. That's why sometimes everything collapses for them. Be'ezrat Hashem, this year just started. We're only 1 month into it. Prepare for horrible year. That's the truth. But at least save yourself. Because when Chas V'Shalom, something is going to happen in the world, Hashem is going to review each person. You have enough Torah. You have enough kindness. You help others. You feel bad for the poor. You're nice in the house. You're a good father. You're teaching your children Torah. You put your kids in yeshivot. Or you send them to learn with Bruce Lee and Fatma in the same class. What did you do? That's what's going to save you. What do you think? Every person will be reviewed. Read in the prophecies. Hashem said, first of all, 2/3 of the world will be killed in a minute. 4 billion people will be erased from the planet in 1 second. The 2.1 or 2.2 billion that would left, Jews and non-Jews, will be coming now, will be put in a net, screening you. How much dirt you have into you. Read Zechariah 14. Go home and read it. I'm going to clean them like you clean the silver with the fire. To see if they deserve to see the face of Mashiach or no. Some people will have a chance, a trial basis, which will be mainly suffering. Suffering. First, all the relatives that didn't keep mitzvot, they all cleaned already. So he had his brother, he had his sister, he had his parents, Chas V'Shalom, some of his kids. It's going to be enough tragedies to worry about. Second, he himself will need a trial basis to make enough tshuva. But some people will not even get to that point. I didn't write the Tanakh. Read in Zechariah 14. The entire end is over there. And we are closer to that more than ever. The world never been in such situation. Who knows what's going to be next? Somebody crazy in Russia will press the atomic bomb missiles because we have nothing to lose anymore. And all of a sudden, or Pakistan, there will be a next president tomorrow. They have atomic bombs enough. Enough. Or Iran already have, who knows? Pakistan could sold them a long time ago. Or maybe they did. Why are they so confident with themselves, the Iranians? Doesn't make sense. Probably already have it. They play with the whole world. We don't know. Every second you can find out Chas V'Shalom something on the news that from there you're going to realize that's it. What's going to be your spiritual situation? What's going to be? Is it going to be possible to correct or are you going to be so deep in the mud that you're going to say that's it, I'm a lost case already. Well, I'm going to divorce Christine. My children are goyim. What am I going to do? I'm going to tell them to convert now? Anyway, they're not going to be my children. So where do I start? Sometimes the people are so deep in their sins. They tell me, I really want to be righteous. I really want to be tzaddik. My wife doesn't let me. I have a guy. He's begging to keep Shabbat. One Shabbat I force him to keep. Don't worry about your wife. She took the kid and left the house. So his test, who do you love more? Me or your wife and your children? It's a very hard test. How many people will pass such a test? How many you know that will say, God, with all the respect, I'm losing my wife, I'm losing my children for you? No. How many? Why should you bring yourself to this situation? Why did you marry the wrong woman? If you would listen to me a year ago, or 5 years ago, or 10 years ago, you wouldn't need to such situation. You wouldn't get it. The idea was to make repentance before you bring so many problems to yourself. Right now you're sitting here, you're going to ignore what I say probably. Tomorrow you go back to your life. That's it. That's the nature of the people. A year from now, you're going to say, why didn't I listen a year ago? And now I'm sure you're saying, why didn't I listen to him a year ago? I have people, sometimes they're calling me, sometimes I get good news. Remember he spoke to me about this and this and this. I listened to you, I did this and this. Now I realize I got saved, everything is okay. I'm not going to go to jail. I did get married. You know, all kinds of things like this. Don't come to me for legal advice. I'm just... The idea is clear or not? We finish for tonight. It's hopefully it's a wake-up call. If you have any questions, you can ask me in person. Thank you very much, and good luck to everyone. Bezrat Hashem.